was musical linguistic
Greetings from Cyberdelic Space. This is Lorenzo, and I'm your host here in the Psychedelic Salon. As you might remember, a few weeks ago, my friends Ron and Claudia gave me a ride up to Lone Pine, where we spent several days visiting with Gene and Myron Stolaroff. And you'll remember some of the earlier conversations I had with the Stolaroffs at their home in the high desert, as well as my podcast of the talk Myron gave at the 100th birthday celebration for Dr. Albert Hoffman. And if you missed those programs, they are podcast numbers 83, 84, and 60. So I'll let you refer back to them for some of Myron's background, which you can also read about in his autobiography, Tantos to Eros, and in John Markoff's great book, What the Dormouse Said, which talks about Myron's work at the Institute for Advanced Studies, where participants learn to use LSD as a tool in their creative work. After the U.S. began the prohibition of psychedelics like LSD, the Institute closed, but Myron and his wife Jean continued their work with various legal psychoactive compounds until the government finally banned all research into virtually every psychedelic substance known and unknown. And during the transitional years, when the medicinal use of these substances, such as MDMA, was being closed down, well, that's when another professional in the field, who at the time was called the Secret Chief, did some of his best work. And it eventually fell to Myron to chronicle this important work in a book of the same name, The Secret Chief. And so now I'll pick up on a conversation Myron and I had during a quiet Saturday afternoon while we were sitting on a couch in his living room. And we were just beginning to talk about how he went about writing his book about Leo Zeff, the man who was once known as the Secret Chief. And that's where I'll pick up. Oh, and one more thing. If you think you're hearing the wind blowing a couple times during this conversation, you'll be correct. It was a very windy day, as you will soon hear. I guess as a result, I never really gave much thought to how you went about doing the book. So, but of course, you'd known Leo for a long time, and so then you sat down and just interviewed him for the book.
Oh, yeah. Gene and I worked together. We went to visit him, and we spent time, and we recorded everything that was being said, and we probably got together with him several times until we'd covered the whole documentation. And at first, you know, we did it on the agreement that we developed the information, but we wouldn't necessarily present it. And so what made it get prevented is that Leo left us. So then we had to agree with several people that were really close to him, and from that we went ahead and developed the book.
And was he happy about getting this out there eventually, or excited? Did he feel about it?
Oh, I think he felt very good about it. I think he was happy that somebody was interested enough to present the material, and so he was happy to cooperate.
And he trained so many people. I know he trained George
hundreds.
Greer and his wife Requa, among others, because we did a podcast with them. But yeah, I guess hundreds of people he must have trained. Huh? Now, do you know? And I'm going to ask some questions that are in the book that the people should go out and read the book. But how did he personally take MDMA with the people when they were taking their training, or did he?
I don't think so. I think. He preferred to just sit with them and just be alert and present. Mm-hmm. I don't think he felt like he had to take anything.
I was talking more about the trainers when he was training the other therapists that were doing it. I remember George and Requa tell the story about they took it themselves first before they gave it to anybody else as therapists. And so I guess that would be part of the training for everybody is... don't give this medicine to somebody if you haven't taken it yourself.
Oh, I'm pretty sure that would be essential.
what was his name? Phil Donahue used to do these talk shows on television. And this is back around 86, maybe. No, it was probably around 84 when MDMA had hit the streets in Dallas as ecstasy, and it was really getting big. And he did a program, a whole hour program on it, in which he had several different points of view represented on stage. You know, I had a DEA guy and a doctor and then a therapist. But the audience was full of people who had, I think, probably been helped by people maybe that Leo had trained, because person after person got up on the audience saying, oh, let me tell you what it did for me, and let me tell you what it did for me.
Oh,
and
for heaven's sake.
It was, for years I had a copy of that tape until I loaned it to somebody and it disappeared. But I'm sure there's a archive somewhere of all his programs that it could be recovered eventually. But that was when it was still legal. And, you know, people could talk about it and talk about their work with it. So it's amazing what's been happening just recently with what Michael Mithoffer is doing with PTSD and MDMA, that he's had some just really amazing results. And if I remember right, he believes now that many cases of post-traumatic stress disorder, at least that are associated with rape, can actually... most of the people can be essentially cured of the heavy-duty problems with PTSD in as few as one or two MDMA sessions with a skilled psychotherapist. But they do the whole session, and then the person stays there that night, and they cook them a meal, and they keep them for the whole, you know, like a 18-hour session. It's not like you just go to the doctor's office and do it, and they send you on the way home. So I think they're doing a very responsible job of it. Yeah. What would be the highlights? You know, what are some of the things that you've had this huge, long, exciting career? You've known all these people from Sasha to Hoffman, and then all the participants and everything, the craziness in the '60s. That anything stand out as either more comedy or more tragedy than any others?
Well, first of all, I don't think there's any tragedy. I think we're pretty lucky to get around that. We spent quite a bit of time, you know. At first, we were fortunate to be able to have experiences with compounds that were promising, and so it meant a lot for us personally. And then in due time, we had moved over here. We'd gotten quite a bit of information, and we began to feel that it was worthwhile dealing with other people who might be interested. And so that lasted for over 10 years, I think. We'd have people come maybe every other week, and sometimes it might be two or three people, probably not for more than four others besides ourselves. And we did that for quite a few years, and we enjoyed it, and I think the people who went through it, I think they were very grateful and they enjoyed it. I don't think we ran into any real difficulties. Every once in a rare while, you might find somebody who's kind of scary or afraid, and I don't really remember specifically that there was anyone who's really in bad shape. But by and large, most of the people we're very happy and had a lot of benefit from just participating and experiencing those things.
You know that you've been associated with this for more than 50 years now, so it's probably an unfair question to ask, but it's the question I get asked most often is people say, you know, I'm sitting out here and wherever in the hills of Scotland or the outback of Australia or a big city in China, and I think I'm the only person around in this whole part of the country that's interested in these subjects. How do I find other people? And, you know, I usually tell them, well, you know, you have to go somewhere, go to a conference or something like that to meet them. That you've had no problem finding people because people find you. You have any ideas about that?
Well, it's an interesting thing to think about. I don't know. It seemed to all fall together pretty naturally. Of course, you know, we had wonderful guides ourselves where we learned about different substances and what it meant for us personally. And then in time, we began to recognize how some of these things could be used with other people. So then we began opening the doors and having more and more people come. So that I'd say over 10 or 15 years, we had actually worked with quite a few people. Mm-hmm. And the way that it spread, you know, we'd start with people that we knew and were interested. And then they, in turn, you know, they enjoyed the experience and felt it was worthwhile. And so they would introduce us to other people and say, is it all right if so-and-so comes and so on. Mm-hmm. And so that just kept growing and growing. And so it kept going for, I don't know the exact number, somewhere between 10 and 20 years. I'm pretty sure it was 10 years at least. But that went on for quite a while, and we really enjoyed doing that work.
Yeah, you know, I guess in my own case, I spent so many years feeling isolated, and then finally I met one or two people, and they introduced me to somebody else, and I met somebody else, and now it seems like everybody I know is involved in psychedelics. That, uh-huh. And I don't, by involved, I don't mean they're... A lot of my friends who I would consider involved don't really use psychedelics. Some have never used them, but they're mm-hmm. fascinating. And I've got a lawyer friend who's just intrigued with LSD, but he's never been able to screw up the courage to take it, all these years. And and I can understand that. I was pretty intimidated my first time. But I came in, you know, a whole generation after you were using it, and I'd come in after all the government scares about all this thing, all the false information they put out. And so a lot of people have to overcome that. But, you know, at breakfast this morning, Jean was I forgot how she said it, but she said, oh, yeah, everywhere you go, you're riding on a shuttle from the airport to a hotel or something. You strike up a conversation about psychedelics. How do you approach strangers? I mean, if you're just sitting on a bus with somebody, do you just strike up a conversation?
I really had a lot of fun with that. I had to go to catch an airplane, and we're usually at my daughter's house, and it's quite a distance to the airport. And so we'd get
The shuttle?
The shuttle. Yeah, we'd have the shuttle come pick us up. And it took, 45 minutes usually to get over there. So we'd get in, and, you know, sooner or later they'd pick up other people. There'd be a few people in mm-hmm. the car. And if they were close, and if they looked friendly, I might... bring up the issue and ask questions and so on, and it kind of struck me that how frequently it was that somebody that were sitting there, usually it's not a big, I think it is only maybe a half a dozen people that would get in the same mm-hmm. unit, but almost always I get the interest of at least one person, and maybe some more than that. And then we go from there, you know, and just see how far we're willing to discuss it. I don't think I was ever totally shut off. It might have been that sometimes, you know, nobody was interested, and so you just had to forget it. But it was kind of interesting. I think I got somebody's interest almost every time.
I wouldn't be surprised.
And I just did it just to see if I could raise that interest.
Well, it beats talking about politics and religion, you know. That.
and, of course, you know, I always had to be careful, you know, that I'm not doing anything now.
Right.
This is stuff that used to do, unfortunately, our stupid government shut things down. So not much is going on, but we were fortunate that there was a time when we could do these things.
And at least we can, at least for the time being, still talk about these things.
Yeah.
So
hopefully
that'll go on. But so, yeah, you never had any ugly incident with anybody preaching to you about the evils of these substances? Or
not
anything?
A one. Not a one.
Yeah, I've been amazed at how many times I've been someplace, and one way or another the subject comes up, and next thing you know, everybody's gathered in the conversation. You know, it's. I think there's just a lot more interest in these things than anybody really has an inkling about.
Well, I think that's absolutely right, and it seemed to me we were pretty lucky that we very often had people join us in the car we were going in, and were curious, or sometimes they had better information, and they enjoyed pursuing it.
Yeah, I think that's the whole thing, is you just start talking to people, and one thing leads to another, and so that I found that it's really, in my life at least, in my case, it's more important for me to be in contact with people that I can talk to about these things than actually even have access to the substances. You know, that I wasn't always like that. I was in a phase, you know, when you first get involved and you get all inflated, and I, at least, you know, I got carried away, and I thought, wow, this is going to change the world and save the whole human race, and I still believe that, by the way. It's just it didn't happen as quickly as I thought, you know.
Well, unfortunately, our government really put the clamps on.
Yeah.
So it's really sad. You know, the thing that's so sad, and I report this any time that I can, but what's so sad is we're supposed to be one of the most understanding people of the whole world. So it's very disappointing to see the way everything's been shut down, and you're not able, made it outlawing to fool around with these substances.
Yeah, something that just struck me when you said we're supposed to be the most open people, and we, the people on the vans going to the airports, really are open, apparently. You know, but it's our government that really shut all this stuff down.
The government is the one that's totally responsible for making all this stuff difficult.
You know, well, these things eliminate fear and break down boundaries, and, you know, that's how they keep us all in check with the boundaries and the fear. And so I can see how these substances are a threat to the status quo, which the status quo never stays the same very long, even though people fight to maintain it.
Oh, the DEA, they've been the toughest one. To a man, they're really refuting these things, and with all the power that they have. And they're not interested in learning anything about it. They're not interested in learning if there's anything possible. We're just really lucky that in the last maybe 3 years or so that we've been able to get a few of these projects opened.
Yeah.
And hopefully we hope that those will grow, and some of them are showing great success. And so based on that, they'll begin to expand, and then more and more people will be able to have access to it.
Right.
And it should really begin to grow. So it's been a very slow process, but at least there's still some hope in there.
Yeah, I think there is a little ray of hope. And, you know, the people who are just now getting really to retirement age are, you know, the children of the 60s. And a lot of those at least had one or two experiences you'd hope they would remember fondly. And and yet there's a whole... The following generation grew up under the just say no draconian rules, and now I think it's like skipped a generation, because the people I know who are 30 and under are really much more like what you guys were back in the 50s and 60s pioneering these things. Is that for one thing, they're armed with a lot of information that nobody's had before because of the internet.
And that's really helpful.
I think that's made a big difference, that You know, it's still a lot of young people, and I wasn't that young when I got involved, but I started, and it felt good. I enjoyed it, you know, and granted, I was starting to make some spiritual connections and work on some issues myself and our family, but on top of all of the positive benefits like that, it just felt good, you know, and human beings like to do things that feel good, so... Mm-hmm. Now I think it's happening where a lot of young people are encountering these substances for the first time at gatherings, at raves, at dances, parties, not even a majority of them, but a significant percentage of them seem to get it, you know. Mm-hmm. And then they'll go out and start doing the work in smaller groups and really start paying attention. And they're the ones that are coming to Arrowhead and reading your books and the Shulgin's books and really searching out the information, trying to learn how to better do these things. So,
yeah. And fortunately, there are people producing books and producing excellent information that's available.
Yeah, I know just, I've only been involved in this in, 20-some years, and back in the beginning, when I was involved, you know, it's like pulling teeth to find out any information. That there'd be a few mimeograph sheets that were passed, or Xerox sheets, you know, passed around. That here's some information. But now, you could spend the next 6 months full time at Arrowhead and still not even get halfway through their material. You know that there's.
Well, they're doing a great job, and actually, I think the government is using them too. You know,
right.
They realize that they're careful and they're honest, and a lot of times they get very worthwhile information from them.
Yeah, I've heard that the government does contact them, and because their information is rock solid, it's been researched, and those are hardworking people up there.
They are. They really are. They're a wonderful couple.
They are. But the information, at least, is readily available now, and people keep, not many, but I get frequent requests for, you know, how do I find this stuff? Everybody always says, well, you can trust me, you know, and I'm sure I probably could, but, you know, first of all, I make a point of not knowing where to find stuff, because when I started doing these podcasts, I thought, you know, I better be squeaky clean.
Yeah.
But, I've kind of gotten to the point where I think that if you start researching this and thinking about it and really kind of working on yourself and paying attention, somehow they seem to find you. I don't know quite how to do that, but I'd spent years just really trying to figure out how I could do ayahuasca. And then all of a sudden, without me even thinking about it, the opportunity just popped into my face, you know, and it turned out to be a good time for me. So,
good.
These medicines have a little spirit of their own that they seek you out. Certainly sought you out. Did you have much experience with mushrooms, or was yours mainly work in chemicals?
We've had mushrooms. I can remember a case or two, and this goes back quite a few years. I can remember some where it was pretty intense, but it ends up with a tremendous opening.
Mm-hmm. Mm. How did you enjoy the plant experience any differently from a chemical experience? There's a lot of pros and cons about that.
Oh, I don't know. I think you have to be careful how you assign those things. what determines what's happening is a lot of the stuff that you've already experienced, and a lot of us have stuffed a lot of stuff down out of consciousness.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we've got, even starting from childhood, you run into difficulties, places where you've been mistreated, and maybe going up to school, running into people who were not friendly, and all this kind of stuff. What happens with a lot of people is they just push that away and pretend that it's not there.
Yeah.
But it is there until you really willing to open and see what it is. And that's not easy. And I've been through that process. Now I'm talking about going back 10, maybe 10 to 15 to 20 years. Mm-hmm. And this is when times, actually when some of these materials were still legal, at least mm-hmm. they hadn't been knocked out. And it takes a lot of courage to learn that you need to open your heart and allow whatever it is you've stuffed down within yourself and that's holding you down. Even though it's painful, you're much better off if you're willing to experience the pain, be with it, and let it go. Because once it breaks through and it's gone, you're at a whole new level. Mm-hmm. And it's an enormous opening, and it's you feel worlds better because you've been freed up. And sometimes that just you just realize, well, now, you know, I got through that one. There's another one down here that's pretty tough and dragging. So, you know, I got through the other one. Maybe I'll make my way out of this one. You work your way out of that one, and you feel even better. Then finally you realize that, my God, you should never try to not handle those things. Mm-hmm. The important thing to do is to be willing to get right into the heart of it. And there are ways to do that, and there are people who have described that, and that's really very important and very helpful.
Yeah, Ann Shulgin talks about that some, and because I asked her one time about, because I've really only had one or two times, I would say, I had a bad trip. Mm-hmm. And so I asked her, am I saving up for the mother of all bad trips? And she said, only if you're not willing and prepared to handle stuff that comes up, just exactly what you said, that mm-hmm. if you can deal with those things, and then you can move on and you have the openings. And
yeah.
I guess the only thing that's from time to time discouraged me a little bit is I'll have those epiphanies after I clear out some garbage, and mm-hmm. and the next week or so I'm just really flying high, and then the old habits kick in and that stuff starts coming back again, you know. And I do have to say that after a number of years now, that doesn't really happen too much anymore, but I was really discouraged for a while there, thinking, gosh, you know, I'm never getting through.
Yeah, there's you think that just because you did this everything's okay, but you forget that there's layers of other stuff there waiting to be released. And so the sooner you're willing to face that and open that up, the more quickly you can get free of all that stuff. And when you do get free, you feel better and better, and you're more alive, mm-hmm. and life is a lot better. So, but I have a lot of trouble with that because I have a lot of deep places which are very hurting, and they're so hurting, you know, don't want to deal with them. Mm-hmm. So you have to make the decision mm-hmm. of what you want to do. And I've learned that it's very, very helpful to really be willing to feel discomfort and pain, mm-hmm. to stay with it until it opens up. Because once you're released from it, it's a whole new life. And see, a lot of times, the release that you get comes from areas that were so painful and so difficult that we've stamped them down, and we refuse to, in our consciousness, to admit that it's there. Mm-hmm. It's just too much to handle. Mm-hmm. And so we pretend we're okay, but actually we're still carrying all this pain around. And but it just takes time to realize that you can get rid of it, and you have to be willing to do whatever is necessary. If it's hurting, and it's hurting real bad, you just have to face it and be with it.
Mm-hmm.
And eventually it lets go, and my God, it's just such a relief when that happens.
Yeah.
You're a new person.
But, you know, in a way, I'm in the process of going through some of that right now. And a few weeks ago, I was at a kind of a bad point where I didn't want to face up to something. I was trying to avoid it.
and something in the past. And this dear friend of ours down in Southern California, he said, well, you know, you can't change the past, but you can change the way you think about it. I mean, that's such a simple thing. Mm-hmm. And so I started changing the way I think about mm-hmm. this series of events in the past. Mm-hmm. Because I can't change, you know, up until then, I'd been beating up myself thinking, well, if I'd only done this, or I should have done this, or mm-hmm. I could have done that. And now I think, well, you know, I can't change that, but I can, what did I learn about it? What do we all learn about it? And mm-hmm. sometimes that involves calling people up and talking, or writing letters, or getting mm-hmm. together with them and say, hey, you know, let me rewind here. And, mm-hmm. and that's really hard for me to do sometimes. But
yeah, but it's very, very worthwhile. See, the main trouble in all this stuff is that there is a part of us that's frightened and are afraid of the pain, and they don't want to deal with it, and so you try to pretend that it's not there. But it is there. Mm-hmm. And as long as it's there, it's going to control you. You're going to feel it. You're going to run into situations where it hurts. Mm-hmm. And just the sooner that you decide, you know, I got to get rid of that and be willing to really do whatever it takes to go through it and see what it is that you have locked up, be willing to face it and experience mm-hmm. it, because once it comes to the surface and released, you're through with it.
Yeah.
That's what's really, really important.
Yeah, the letting go. What is it? He said something else that, gosh, I don't know if I can quite remember it. Is moving on is letting go transformed.
Uh-huh.
And,
yeah, that's very well said.
Yeah, moving on is letting go transformed. And mm-hmm. A couple of these simple little aphorisms, if I can keep them in my head, you know, mm-hmm. I can get through these hard days sometimes. Yeah. Although, in all honesty, the hard days and weeks of my life are over. I'm probably never been at a better point in my life.
Wonderful.
I've never been happier, more fulfilled. Now, that doesn't mean I don't have a lot of problems. I've got the whole bundle of fears and anxieties but I don't pay much attention to them anymore. You know, they're still
great.
There, but
that's great.
And
it shows, you know, because you're really very alive. And you're fun to be with, and
but you know, I really owe my life to all of these medicines. That I was heading down a really dark way before I met them, you know, and really all they've done for me, I mean, and it's everything. It's given me my life, but all it really did, it didn't transform me or change me into somebody new. It took me back to who I was when I was a boy before I had all of this other layers of stuff put on me. I got back to my old dreaming self, sitting up in the maple tree guy, you know, and I'm not totally there yet, but no, mm-hmm. none of us ever will be, I don't think, but the fact that right now, actually, if I really, for example, if I had a recurrence of my cancer, I would have no fear about it at all. The first thing I would do is head down to Peru, to the Amazon, and to my ayahuasca that I know down there, because I am so absolutely convinced that I could deal with anything that way.
Wonderful.
And that's a tool that maybe hopefully I'll never have to use that way, but knowing that these tools are there, and you know, if there's a relationship issue, you have a tool of MDMA that you can use. You know, mm-hmm. if you have a creativity issue, there's the LSD tool to use. You know, there's a lot of different tools that could and, you know, these things, I don't know. I don't know if you've given any thought, but it seems so strange that we could evolve these complex brains and have all these neat little receptors, and then these plants would grow that have these, that fit in these little receptors, these molecules that make it. It can't be an accident that these psychoactive plants in our brains have co-evolved into some sort of a symbiosis to lift us, you know, out of flatland into another dimension. It just seems to me no accident. But then again, maybe that's how I rationalize my love for using these medicines, you know.
Well, once you reach some of these higher levels and realize how pure the purity, absolute purity, the fantastic love, that's there waiting for us. And from time to time, we can feel it at times. And when we know that that's very real, and that's probably the most important thing we can do, is to get into that stage. That's the most important thing that we could possibly do. So if we focused on that and worked on that, and I have to be careful here, you know, I said, I used the word worked on that, and the working is not, you know, really struggling and trying to make things happen. It isn't that at all. What it is learning to just be still, to just let everything go, just absolutely be still and let our hearts open. Because as that opens, we get into the area that we're really looking for, you know, where we're really alive, where this is it, man. This is really what it's all about, and it's pure, absolutely pure love.
You know, I hadn't made that connection exactly like that, the pure love, until just this moment. Because you got me thinking about Sasha has this scale, the plus five scale, where a plus one is a little tingle, you know, there's something active going on, and plus five is the pure love, the bliss, but when you come back, you can't remember anything, and plus four is what you're going for, it's right on the edge of bliss, but you remember it. And I'd not translated that until this moment, but that plus five state is that pure love. I've been there a few times, and what you said is exactly what how I've approached those plus five states. You know, and I've not been there that often, but when you come back and somebody says, "Well, you know, how was it? What happened?" You know, said, "It was incredible." Well, what was it like? I don't know.
You got to go one step further. That I don't know. You got to get rid of the I don't know, because you know.
Well, I guess you really know. You're exactly right. I can't put it into words, is I guess the answer. But that's exactly what you said. Is that you come back, and while maybe you can't know exactly how to put this into your daily life at the moment, but you know that your core, and everybody's core, and where we're all touching each other, is this core of love, and that's that state that I sometimes Mary C. and I sometimes I joke with her that I've had several experiences that were like so incredibly blissful, but after a while, I thought, hey, it's time for this to be over. I want the next act. What's going on next? But I just stayed in this state of perfect bliss for way too long, 20, 30 minutes, way too long. And I came back and I said,
too long? How could it be too long?
That's what she keeps saying. I said, you know what? Bliss is really boring after a while. I think we come back to this plane here just because we've been so blissed out, we're bored, and we want a little pain and agony so that we can appreciate the bliss. I don't know.
I
really did get to the point where, and this one particular experience where it was just like, wow, you know, and I did feel like I could stay there forever.
But why not?
But nothing was happening, you know, there was no action, no adventure. It's just, I was just at a perfect state of bliss. You know, I guess I wanted to talk to somebody. I didn't want to, I felt alone. Maybe that's what it was. It's, you know, some of the different religious myths and legends talk about a God figure, you know, why did a God create a universe? Well, because it was lonely. And I've been in a couple of those states where I felt like I was the only soul in the cosmos. And that pure bliss state was one of those where I just needed somebody to talk to. Yeah.
But you see, you're already them. They are already you. We're all one together.
You know, I do tell myself that a lot, that, you know, and particularly when I see somebody that irritates me, you know, it's what about that, what in that person am I seeing in myself? What's reflecting back? And so I've just had to stop watching the news. Well, there's so much about me I don't like in the news.
Yeah, but you know, you're overlooking the fact that you have an opportunity there, because you look at someone and... Of course, I think probably you have to be pretty well settled down for yourself and be feeling really good. And then you see another person and they're having problems and they're hurting, and you can recognize that and you can wish them well. Mm-hmm. And you can send love to them and help them. Hopefully, it might help them lift themselves up.
Good point.
And begin to change their lives.
Something I've been thinking about a lot lately is, because I've got these new grandchildren coming into my life, and you know, they talk about stem cell research, and you get a stem cell, and it can become any kind of a cell. And I think these little infants that come into the world are sort of like stem cells. You know, if you take a baby, no matter where it's born, and put it in an American family, or you take the same baby, put it in a Vietnamese family or a Chinese family, no matter where that child is placed, all of the overlays of family and society and culture and religion get laid into that. But that same little being could have been a Muslim or a Christian or a Jew or a Buddhist, depending on where they got the overlays put in. And so I see these medicines as cleaning house, cleanse the doors of perception, get rid of the overlays back to your little innocent stem cell body and say, now I'm going to take charge. And I'm going to put the, you know, we all put overlays back on, but am I going to overlay myself as a Buddhist or as a Muslim or as, you know, just a free thinker who likes the spiritual tradition and picks the best ones out of it? I think that's really maybe what we're in the process of doing with some of these medicines, is getting rid of the childhood things back to the pure, innocent beings we are. Because these little babies, when they, you know, they just gurgle and goo, and, you know, and, and as they get older, they start adapting the social norms. And, you know, I don't know, but I really think that there's just so much hope for humanity if we could... just all get along.
Right.
Our conversation rambled on from there for a while, but most of it wouldn't really be of much interest to you, I don't think. Mainly, we talked about the big windstorm we were experiencing and the fact that there was very little snow in the mountains this year. So it was a nice surprise when we got up the next morning and found that a snowstorm had blanketed the High Sierra during the night. And I'll post a picture of that scene with the program notes for this podcast if you want to see what it looked like. And you can find those notes at www.psychedelicsalon.org. At the breakfast table on Sunday morning, when Myron started to tell a story about the last time he saw Alan Watts, I asked him if it was okay to turn on my recorder again, and so now we have a couple more of Myron Stolaroff's Lone Pine stories.
You know, it's funny. You and I had talked a couple of times about Alan Watts, and you were about to say the last time that you saw him.
Hubbard and I met him in San Francisco. I went to breakfast with him, and he was on his way to go he was going to go east and see Tim Leary, and Hubbard. You know, by this time, we had seen a lot of things going on, and the way people were doing things, and Hubbard was very disturbed that these things weren't being handled very well. And, see, Leary had taken a bunch of people down to Mexico. They had a big place there. In fact, I was down there part of the time with them.
Oh, really? I didn't know that.
So, they had been there, and they'd had a bunch of people getting together and had their own ways of handling things, and some of it I was there for a while, and I didn't think they were handling things too well, but anyway, Larry was getting out of hand and getting into all kinds of stuff, and it, so something really needed to be done to hold that back, and so he told us that he'd look into it and he'd take care of everything. But when he got there, he just went right in with him. He thought everything we were doing was great. I'm pushing it out all over the place.
So that was
my last experience with that.
So sending Alan Watts to calm down Leary is like throwing gasoline on the fire, huh?
Right, exactly. That's exactly what happened.
I guess that's the first time I've heard, too, that Hubbard had gotten concerned about what Leary was up to. I guess we hadn't talked about that. But Hubbard just was getting nervous about all of the press. Is that...
things just were getting out of order. And all kinds of stuff was going on. And the people who were on the list, Osmond and Hopper... They said, you get him off or we're getting off. Well, you know, these are real outstanding people and also very dear friends. So I went up to tell him that we had to take him off. Of course, all the other guys around there were very supportive of him, and they thought it was awful and all. But then I said, well, you know, he's getting kicked out of Harvard. And they said, oh, that's a lot of crap. Those are rumors that they're going all the way around. And I said, Tim, is that right or isn't it? He never told his own people that they were kicking him out of Harvard. Can you imagine that?
Well, it's consistent with the character I've heard of and from other sources. What was their reaction? Were they like,
Well, it hurts, you know. Here's your key guy, you know, you think you're with him. You think everything's going okay. You find out he's getting kicked out, and they didn't even tell you.
I imagine there was a little tension around the dinner table after that.
Oh, there was. There was. Anyway, the next morning I was leaving. I had to leave early to catch a plane, and so I went up. I said, you know, I don't have it in my heart to tell you not to do what you're doing, but really, what you're doing is not going in the right directions. And so I said goodbye to him. And then when I got home, I thought, Jesus Christ, what's the matter with me? You know, what he's doing is incorrigible. So I wrote him a long letter. And sent it back. I don't think I ever heard from him anymore.
Did you keep a copy of that letter?
It might be somewhere. I don't know if I can find it.
Well, if you find it, of course, I'd love to see it. But so that you know, that letter still exists. I'm almost 100% sure because I've had some contact with the people who are trying to sell his archives to the university, and I've seen pictures of the storage sheds where it is. Hundreds and hundreds of catalog boxes, and the man never threw a thing away, including his grade school report cards. So any letter, Leary, yeah, and so any correspondence he got from anybody, I'm sure all of any correspondence between him and your institute is still in existence. So someday that will be in some university archive where scholars can go through and see it. So it's nice to know it exists. I just thought you should know.
Since this program is a bit long, I'm going to bring it to a close now, even though there have been several emails about ayahuasca that I'd like to cover. I'm still planning on posting parts of these email conversations on our program notes page, which you can find at www.psychedelicsalon.org. And in case you went there over the weekend looking for those postings, well, I have to apologize for not getting them online yet, but my intentions are honorable, and so I'll eventually get some of this correspondence edited and posted. Until then, I guess I should say that there have been several experienced psychonauts who have different opinions than Mateo and I do about the ayahuasca diet, and more importantly, there are differing opinions about the wisdom of using ayahuasca as a solo journey outside of the normal support structure offered by an experienced ayahuascaro. And while I haven't changed my own opinion, I do think that some of these other opinions are also worth considering, and so I'll pass them along and let you make these kinds of decisions on your own. But I do want to thank everyone who has sent emails about this topic, and I'll do my best to get your questions answered and your comments aired. Before I go, I want to mention that this and all of the podcasts from the Psychedelic Salon are protected under the Creative Commons Attribution Non-Commercial Sharealike 2.5 license. If you have any questions about that, just click on the Creative Commons link at the bottom of the Psychedelic Salon webpage. And if you have any questions, comments, complaints, or suggestions about these podcasts, well, just send them to lorenzo@matrixmasters.com. Thanks again to Jacques and friends at Chateau Hayuk for the use of your music here in the salon, and a big thank you goes out to Jean and Myron Stolaroff for their hospitality, and to Ron and Claudia not only for making this interview possible, but also for the many great adventures we shared together over the past few years. I really appreciate your friendship and support, you guys. The Psychedelic Salon wouldn't be what it is today without your help. And I also appreciate you being here in the salon today again. It's really great to have you with us on this mystical journey into the unknown. And for now, this is Lorenzo signing off from Cyberdelic Space. Be well, my friends.